Hello doctors, today let's talk about a hot and burning topic. Yeah, it is about GERD and Barrett's esophagus. Now, GERD means gastroesophageal reflux disease. Now, this is reflux of gastric contents into the esophagus or into the oral cavity. Now, the problem here is decrease in tone of the lower esophageal sphincter. Now let's see what is LES. LES is lower esophageal sphincter. If you see here, this is the lower esophageal sphincter that is present at the lower part of the esophagus. It is a tight muscle-like thing which can close and open the pathway. So, whenever food comes from the esophagus, this LES will open and allow the food to pass from the esophagus into the stomach. But when the stomach acid tries to go up, this lower esophageal sphincter closes tightly and stops the reflux of the acid. If you see here in this picture, you can see the lower esophageal sphincter is closed and stops the acid reflux. But in GERD, the problem is the tone of the lower esophageal sphincter is decreased, or you can say that the strength of this muscle is decreased. So what happens when the tone of the LES is decreased? The acid can easily go up into the esophagus, which causes the problem GERD. Now, what are the risk factors that can decrease the tone of the LES? Let's see. First one is obesity. When you are obese, your intra-abdominal pressure can rise. That is, pressure on this side can rise, causing opening of the lower esophageal sphincter. Or even in pregnancy, the same thing happens. After a heavy meal, this LES tone can decrease, causing GERD. Smoking and alcohol and caffeine also causes decrease in tone of LES. Now, what are the clinical features of GERD? The patient will probably have retrosternal burning pain. That is, behind the sternum, the patient will keep his hands like this and tells that he or she has heartburn. Now, in an elderly patient, you must be aware and you must have in your mind that this is not MI, myocardial infarction, because this is a very close differential diagnosis for myocardial infarction. In the patient, due to the acids ascending up, there can be change of environment and patient can have oral ulcers or ulcers in the esophagus also. And the taste of the patient, that is, he or she may say that they could not feel the taste of the food, or probably they feel metallic taste. Now, normally we would have felt that whenever we take some tablets, we may feel that the food is tasteless. Just like this, the patient has tasteless food. Now, what investigations can be done to confirm the diagnosis? Now, the investigation of choice is 24 hours pH monitoring. That is, if you can see in this patient, there is a tube being sent into the esophagus. This tube constantly monitors the pH. So, whenever there is acid reflux, the pH will tend to go down. And then, in 24 hours, you will see the sum of the pH. Like, how much was it in the past 24 hours? If the pH was equal to or less than 4, then the diagnosis of GERD can be confirmed. We can also do upper GI endoscopy to check any complications of the esophagus and complications of GERD in the esophagus. Now let's see how can we treat this patient. Now, just imagine you are sitting in an OPD and there's this patient comes and says, "Hello doctor, I have this heartburn after my meals and I also feel my food is being tasteless." Right now, if someone says that he cannot feel his or he cannot taste his food, you may think about COVID-19, but that can be a differential diagnosis. Just think about this GERD. The patient says he has heartburn after the meals. So this is probably GERD. Then you should also ask about other relative questions to this, and you do the PE, and then you confirm the diagnosis with 24 hours pH monitoring. Then you start the treatment. Now, the first part in the treatment, that is behavioral modifications. What will you advise your patient so that he will not get episodes of GERD? Tell the patient to avoid late night meals. Probably, when the patient eats in the late night, he would go to sleep immediately. So, when he is lying in the supine position, the food contents in the stomach can cause increase in pressure on that side, pushing, or the food tries to go back into the esophagus. Thereby, the tone of the lower esophageal sphincter decreases. So you should avoid late night meals. And we also saw that the risk factors like smoking, alcohol and caffeine should be avoided. And the patient should take frequent small meals. Like, they should not be big meals which can cause increase in pressure in the stomach. So we'll take small meals in within few hours gap, and this will be helpful in digesting the food in the right time, and there won't be any problems in the tone of the lower esophageal sphincter. And we should also elevate the head side when sleeping. So if you see, when the head is elevated due to gravity, the acids, even if they ascend up, they tend to go down, and the pressure of the lower esophageal sphincter can be maintained. So when the patient comes in and you confirm the diagnosis, this is what you should tell him first. Then this won't be enough. What you have to do is you have to add up a proton pump inhibitor like omeprazole. So the acid production will be decreased. So even if the lower esophageal sphincter is loose, when you decrease the acid production, there won't be any much of acids ascending up, causing the problem heartburn. That's why these are given initially. Now you just see and ask the patient to come back after a month, and the patient comes back after a month and tells that, hey doc, I took the medicines you gave, but the heartburn is still there. So what can I do? As a doctor, we have to think about doing an upper GI endoscopy to find out any complications in the esophagus. So after doing upper GI endoscopy, you find out there are ulcers in his esophagus. So that's a complication of GERD. Plus, the proton pump inhibitors and behavioral modifications are not enough for the patient. If the patient has these two, then the patient can be advised to have a surgical management. In the surgical management, what do we do is that we can do Nissen's fundoplication. Now, if you see, fundo means fundus of the stomach, this part, and plication, you plicate, you take this part and surround it and stitch it. This is called Nissen's fundoplication. If you see here, there is a total circle surrounding the lower esophageal sphincter. This fundus is surrounded completely, that is 360 degree. This is called as 360 degree Nissen's fundoplication. But this had many side effects. That's why we developed modified Nissen's fundoplication, which is the surgery of choice right now. In this, what we do is we do a posterior fundoplication only for 270 degrees. So there is not much of the side effects in this. This procedure is called toupee posterior fundoplication. Now, even in this, we may see some side effects. So what are the common side effects encountered after a surgical management? These are difficulty in swallowing and unable to belch and flatulence. Now, the principle of doing this procedure is increasing the tone of the lower esophageal sphincter with the help of fundus. So, that's how we manage this patient. Now, let's talk about Barrett's esophagus. If you see the esophagus, which has squamous epithelium, and the stomach has columnar epithelium. We all know that in the stomach there are acids produced by the parietal cells, and there is also goblet cells that produce mucin. So in the stomach there is columnar epithelium having parietal cells producing acid and goblet cells producing mucin. Now in the gastroesophageal reflux disease we saw that those acids would ascend up, and then by time they go down, they go up, they go down. This happens for a chronic time. Due to chronic exposure, this part of the esophagus undergoes metaplasia. Metaplasia means change of one epithelium to the another. Since there is chronic acid exposure here, this epithelium changes to a suitable columnar epithelium. Let's see. This was the esophagus squamous epithelium and the stomach's columnar epithelium. Now you can see the columnar epithelium has extended up into the esophagus, which is not normal. So what you have to do is you have to take biopsy at this part to confirm the diagnosis. If you see in the histology slide, this is squamous epithelium and columnar epithelium. You can see the squamous epithelium turning out to be columnar epithelium in the esophagus. This is Barrett's esophagus. Now, in the lower end of the esophagus, there was initially squamous epithelium, which underwent metaplasia, that is change of one epithelium to the another, and it turned out to be columnar epithelium. If you see here, in the lower end of the esophagus, this is squamous epithelium, and this salmon pink color, this one is columnar epithelium. This is the lower esophageal sphincter. Now, what you have to do is take a biopsy at this part and check. Now, normally in squamous epithelium, you should not be seeing goblet cells because those goblet cells are usually present in the stomach. But now you are seeing goblet cells in the squamous epithelium of lower end of esophagus. That means there has been a metaplasia. These goblet cells produce mucin. And to view this mucin in the slides, you have to use Alcyon blue stain. That is a special stain for the mucin. So this part, we took a biopsy and we check under the slide with Alcyon blue stain. You can see these blue parts. These are the mucin. Mucin has been produced by the goblet cells. So we can confirm in the esophagus we have seen goblet cells, which is the hallmark feature of Barrett's esophagus. I repeat, goblet cells are the hallmark features of Barrett's esophagus. Now if you just leave this, those cells can undergo disordered growth or dysplasia and they can become into a cancer cell. Now, what type of cancer will it cause? Is it like squamous cell carcinoma or adenocarcinoma or any other type? You should comment that in the comment box and I will reply you with the correct answer. Now, in the Barrett's esophagus, the most common risk factor is GERD, that is chronic acid exposure. Then the clinical features are just like GERD symptoms, heartburn, and a change in taste, plus the patient will have progressive dysphagia, difficulty in swallowing. Now, what are the complications of Barrett's esophagus? When a patient has this problem, he may develop strictures or ulcers, bleeding, perforations, or malignancy. Whenever there is ulcer, you can relate that there can be bleeding. If there is ulcer going deep down, it can cause perforation, and It also causes malignancy. Now, what type of malignancy? Just comment in the comment section. Then for Barrett's esophagus, what investigation should we do? I already told that we have to do an upper GI endoscopy and we should biopsy the Salmon pink color in the esophagus. So the biopsy will show goblet cells which can be viewed through Alcyon blue stain. This one. This is the Alcyon blue stain picture. Now how can we treat this patient? We can either give PPI or like omeprazole, and we should do regular endoscopy exam for every 2 years to check that if the Barrett's esophagus has turned out into a cancer cell or is it still the same. Or we can do photodynamic ablation or ablate the mucosa with the laser. Even if we do that, the risk of cancer is still there. If it becomes malignant, then esophagectomy will be needed. So regular surveillance of the Barrett's esophagus with upper GI endoscopy for every 2 years is necessary. So that was about GERD and Barrett's esophagus. Don't forget to comment what type of cancer will Barrett's esophagus cause. Thank you, doctors.